heaven. Inshallah.
It should be familiar.
Oh, it's okay?
You don't have to buy this one. Yeah. Which is spirit primitive, you just do.
طيب بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم طيب بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. So we'll start, inshallah, our Fiqh class first, Ulu al-Maram. So what was the last hadith we discussed? Huh? Anybody refresh my memory?
Laqib bin Sabra.
Naam?
Laqib bin Sabra.
Right. Did we cover this?
Yes, covered.
Okay. We finished and then we went to the fawaid, right? We went to the fawaid, which is the fawaid of this hadith. What do we learn from this hadith? And we already mentioned many of these fawaid.
I'm just coming today.
You are welcome.
My friend told that Sunday and Monday there is class.
Yes.
So I don't know whether this one or the, is there another class here?
What type of class you are looking for?
He said one day it is about Quran,
okay.
And other class it is about the Sunnah, how we pray.
Okay, maybe the next room.
Maybe,
yeah. Thank you. Yeah. That's in Okay. So we already talked about this. Today we'll go to Riwayat, to hadith number. Huh?
37, Uthman.
Hadith Uthman?
Yeah.
Okay.
The last was about the
hand.
Naam?
Washing hands, sweet hands. Before putting
finger.
Yeah, yes. Yeah, last point we said that some of the fawaid, and we said, talking about whatever reach the stomach from the nose will be considered as what? Will break the fast. This is why it is not recommended for the person who is in fasting that he make a sniff water, yani excessive water he took in his nose. And it's not sunnah for the one who is fasting to do this. طيب. ولأبي داود في رواية. This is the hadith that we started, which is رواية for أبي داود, which is the same hadith but with different reporter who is أبو داود. He said ولأبي داود في رواية. That means another version by أبو داود. What do you mean by when saying Abu Dawood? Huh? Sunan? Sunan Abu Dawood. Huh? Sunan? طيب. He said, if you perform wudu, then fatamadmad. طيب. وعن عثمان رضي الله عنه أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم كان يخلل لحيته في الوضوء. صح؟ Are we in the right track? Okay. So this is the hadith of عثمان. So we talk about the hadith of عثمان and hadith of Abu Dawood. The first one is the command to perform مضمضة. What do you mean مضمضة? Gargling the water inside the mouth. Huh? Gargling. It's not just put the water and just spit it out, but it should be gargling. That's mean moving inside the mouth to be clean. And for Uthman, كان يخلل لحيته. And we talked last week about التخليل. That's mean he put his hand inside his is the beard to make sure that the water will cover as much as possible of the of the beard. And we'll come to this inshallah in detail. So the lihya, this is the lihya. Where's the lihya? This is the lihya here. Al-arad, that means in both sides. The one which is in the neck, it's not part of the lihya. Okay? This, some people, they get some hair which is grow in their neck. Yeah. This, if you cut it, no problem, because it's not part of the lihya. طيب? The lihya? It's come from, no, from this side.
From here.
Okay? Yeah, from here and go. All this is called lihya. طيب? Clear? So whatever here, also it's part of the lihya. But whatever in the neck itself, it's not part of the lihya. So this is the meaning of the lihya. طيب.
So you mean below the body?
Yeah. Yeah, just, you know, to the point where the connect between the head and the neck. So this is the line here. This is the line. طيب. طيب. The meaning of يُخَلِّ اللَّحِيَتَهُ, that means he gets his the water inside his hair, between the hair, to make sure that the water will cover and wash all the hair. وظاهر قول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم كان يخللها مع طولها. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he have very big, tall beard. It was not small. It was very big, huge. So he used to put his fingers inside his lihya when he's making, whenever he make wudu. طيب. Also, so we learn as the Sheikh said, استحبابه تخليل اللحية. Is doing this, is it recommended? نعم, or it is must? It is sunnah or must? To put the hands and get the water inside. Is it must or?
Must.
You said must? We'll come inshallah, we'll see. I'm just, you know, raise this question so you can think about it. طيب. If the lihya is very big and thick, okay, it is recommended to put the finger, but it's not necessary to get the water inside. Okay? And the water should cover the whole lihya, even if it was tall. Some ulama, they said it's only which is by the face, close to the face. But the correct view, the sound view, is whatever lihya that you have, because all this will be connected to the face. So you should put the water that cover the whole beard. Is it clear? So this is the As-salamu wa rahmatullah. So this is the point here. So it covers it in. طيب. But if the beard was it's not heavy, it is light beard. That means you will find the skin. Yeah, you can see the skin. Then you should make sure that the water go inside, and wash the skin, which is under the hair. Is it clear? Clear? So this is two situations. If the beard is very thick, very tall, then it's recommended, it's sunnah to, but if somebody just wash his hand, I mean wash his face, including the beard, that's okay. It's not must. Okay? But if the beard is very light, that means the skin, you can see the skin, then you should make sure that the water touch and reach the skin. Right? Now, is this situation, I mean, this act, apply in all situation? No. In a matter when it is janaba, and the janaba, which is, you know janaba, what does it mean? The ghusl. To make ghusl, when you are making ghusl, then you should make sure that the water go inside, even if you have very thick beard. Why? Because the hadith, under every hair there is janaba. Every single hair there is janaba. Therefore, you need to make sure that the water reach the skin and you get the water inside as much as you can. This is in the case of what? Of ghusl. In case of ghusl, perform ghusl after janaba. But if it is just wudu, then as I said, we have two situations. If the beard is very light, that the skin is very, you can see the skin, then the water should go inside and touch and clean this skin. If the beard is very thick and tall, then all what you need is what? Just wash your face, including this beard, and it is sunnah to put your finger to make the water go inside or between the hairs. Is it clear? Right. The Sheikh here also, he wants to remind him about things. Now we talk about two solutions and two ways, right? But there's another one. The third one, what is it? When the person is doing or performing tayammum, does he need to make the lihya? That means he get the dust inside? جزاكم الله خير يا ما شاء الله. So التيمم no need to get the dust and say I'm following the sunnah and make تخلل to make the dust or the turab go inside your leg. That's not right. Why? Because تيمم is a symbol of purification. In fact, تيمم doesn't clean anything. Doesn't clean anything. But it's a matter of what? Of a symbol of purification. You got it? So this only apply in the situation of what? Of wudu with what? With water. طيب؟ طيب. طيب. This hadith. وعن عبد الله بن زيد قال إن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أتي بثلثي مد فجعل يدلك ذراعه أخرجه وصححه ابن خزيمة. Look at this hadith. Narrated Abdullah ibn Zayd رضي الله عنه. He said, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم was brought two thirds of a mud. طيب, we'll talk what does it mean, mud. Of water. That mean quantity of water equal to mud. This is one of the scales. طيب, that's scale, to weight quantity. طيب. And he rubbed his arm. Rubbed. Not just wash. Rubbed his arms. This related by Ahmed and Ibn Khuzaymah. طيب, what does it mean, mud?
It's 600 grams of water.
Now let's take the definition for people they don't know grams. Not everybody has a scale of grams, or so you need to tell them something that they can understand.
We have a plan to measure today, but I forget.
One by one, mashallah. One full hand. Okay. We have mud and we have sa'. Okay? We have sa'. Remember this. Sa' is the name also of other scale. And mud. To understand the sa' and the mud. The mud is one full hand of a person of a normal size. That's mean average. Not say he's a huge or big person. That's mean it will be like this. Not very little one also. So it will be what? A normal average
standard person,
the average, the middle. So the full of his hand is called mud. Why they call it mud? Because this is madda, when he extends his hand. So he take and he like this. This is mud. Clear? Right. So as-sa' are And this we remember, we'll talk about inshallah when you come to a hadith about zakah. طيب, about zakah. And zakat al-fitr. Sa'un, you remember? Zakat al-fitr, which is in the end of Ramadan, you know, we give away food. So it is, will be sa', one sa'. What is sa'? How many mud sa'? Huh?
Four mud.
Huh?
Four
mud. Will make one sa'. So this is one sa'. Huh? That's mean four times. Full hand. Put in this container. This will make what? Sa'. طيب. You got now, understand this? طيب. So here, this Sahabi, he said that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was brought, that means somebody, huh, brought it to the Prophet alayhi salatu wa sallam. Brought him mud. Mud of what? And he didn't mention mud of what? He said he was brought a mud. طيب, but in the translation, he put between us that it is water. But it's known from the hadith that why they brought him this water for what?
Ablution.
For wudu, for ablution. فَجَعَلَ يَدْلُكُ يَدَهُ. طيب. What do we need, what do we learn from this hadith? That the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, you see, one full hand, less than one full hand, because two-thirds of the mud, that means less than one full hand. And this, the water, the quantity of the water that the Prophet used for his wudu. What do you think? You think it's too?
Yeah.
Too little. One of us said, well, this I just, you know, use it only in one hand, maybe. Subhanallah. Subhanallah. You see? So the water is a little. But we learn from this that it's not recommended to use excessive water. Right? And support this, the other hadith, when the Prophet ﷺ, he advised one of the Sahaba, قال لا تسرف ولو كنت على نهر جار. Don't use extra water or more water or much water, even you are making wudu where? On the river side. Does this, the river will, even this, there are in a plenty of water, and it's river running, even though, don't use too much water. Because it is not, you know, al-israf, you know, in anything, it's not lawful. It's قال إن المسرفين كانوا إخوانهم إخوان الشياطين. طيب, the one who exceed water, this is like a shaitan. Subhanallah. And this to show you that we should appreciate the gifts and bounties of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We should not use more than what we need. This is what these days they call it, within one of the guidelines of the successful economic system. This is what the Sunnah told us. Don't use more than what we need. In everything. In everything. And if you look at the life of our sister, you see how can they live. They live to their need. But now, mashallah, you see, the three people in the house, and we have 5-6 rooms. Okay? Three people in the house, and there's 5 beds. And, mashallah, for the clothes, how much? Every other day, cars. Huh? Whenever a new model comes, people, they try to get the new one. Mobile. Right? These phones. As long as something that do the job for you, why should you waste your money? Why should you waste all the, Allah Azza wa Jal gave it to you not to be waste. So even the wudu, which is water, which is very important, valuable, even at wudu, which is ibadah, don't use more than what do you need. And here the Prophet ﷺ gave us the example. Why he said he rub his arm with water. Yeah, because the water is little, right or not? If the water is running, there's no need to rub it. Just put it in, run the water and it will cover the hand. But now you have a little, So make sure you take a little and to make sure that it covers all parts, you know, of your arm. Right? طيب in this hadith also the Sheikh said does this dalk, I mean rubbing, is it sunnah or must? According to this it is sunnah. But it's used mostly, as we said, if the water is very little, and then you need to cover, because it's very important in wudu that the water, you know, the wet, it should use, I mean, it should cover all the parts of the wudu. If there's even very tiny space which was not covered by the wudu, on one of the wudu, then this wudu is not valid. And we'll come, inshallah, when you talk about some of the hadith which warn about against such matter. طيب. الغسل فرض والتدلك سنة. This is one of the same. غسل, washing, this is must, فرض. But to rub, it is not must, but it is sunnah. طيب. And what's this is what we mention here. Move to another hadith. وعنه عنهم وعنه and also reported and he mentioned to the previous narrator. Who was the previous narrator? Abdullah bin Zayd. Abdullah bin Zayd. You see that in the Arabic they don't repeat the word that will be understood by the reader. You see? The first time he said عن عبد الله بن زيد, okay? It's what narrated by Abdullah bin Zayd. The second one said and narrated by him. Also. So no need to mention. طيب. So عن عبد الله بن زيد, he saw the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, the hadith in Arabic, يأخذ لأذنيه ماء غير الماء الذي أخذه لرأسه. This reported by Al-Bayhaqi. طيب. Bayhaqi, one of the reporter of the hadith. وهو عند مسلم من هذا الوجه بلفظ ومسح برأسه بماء غير فضل يديه وهو المحفوظ. Now let's explain this. Now we have two forms or two narration, which is in fact one narration, but every reporter he reported with different word. Be careful. We have Al-Imam Al-Bayhaqi, what he said, performing ablution, and he took new water for his ears. Now this is what was reported by whom? By Al-Imam Al-Bayhaqi. Who is the narrator? Abdullah bin Zayd. طيب. Al-Bayhaqi, he said, and he took water, new water, for his ears. That means after he finished from his head, he didn't use the same water for the ears, no. He took a new water. This is, the narration was reported by whom? By Al-Bayhaqi. Now the hadith, the narrator is one. But we have two reports with different wording. Are you following Abdullah? Yeah. Right. Muslim, Imam Muslim, he said, and he wiped his head with water other than that left over after washing his hands. And he wiped his head and he didn't mention the ear. He didn't mention the ear. Right. What's the difference now between two? The narrator is one, the narrator is one, the reporters are two. One by Al-Bayhaqi and one by Al-Imam Muslim. Which one more stronger? Muslim. Al-Imam Muslim. Therefore, we preferred and we depend on what Al-Imam Muslim mentioned. Al-Imam Muslim, he didn't mention that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he took new water for his ears. So from this we learn what? That the water that was used to wash the ears, it is what? The same water that was used for the head. The same thing that we said before. طيب طيب. When can we use the thing which was reported by Al-Imam Al-Bayhaqi? Instead, it's getting dry. Like, for example, there is wind. Huh? And the minute that you take the water, it will get dry very quickly. Some ulama said, in this case, it's okay. You know, that if he, when you do it like this, his hand gets dry and he needs some water, it's okay to take a new water for his ear. You got it?
Yes.
So this is what the Sheikh mentioned about this point. طيب. طيب. So we learn from this hadith, and now يمسح الأذنين بما بقي من الرأس. So now the conclusion, so not be confused. So the conclusion is, the correct and the sound view that when you are performing wudu, then whenever you take a water, and we said we don't take water for the head, what should we do? Just wet the hands. Because for the head is masih, only wiping, not washing. Not washing. Therefore, for the head you don't take water. All what you do is what? Huh? Wet your hand and then go over the head all the way back and then come back again and then you put this point fingers inside and the thumb in behind the ear. Is it clear? So this is the sound view and you don't need to take water twice or to wet your hands twice, one for the head and one for the ear. Right? طيب. Now let's go to the hadith أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه قال. Are we in the same order that we have? حديث أبو هريرة. طيب. وعن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه قال سمعت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول إن أمتي يأتون يوم القيامة غرا محجلين من أثر الوضوء فمن استطاع منكم أن يطيل غرته فليفعل. متفق عليه واللفظ لمسلم. The meaning. Narrated Abu Huraira رضي الله عنه قال The Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم said My nation will come on the day of resurrection with bright streak of height. It's not clear here. No, because the right. My nation will come on the day of the resurrection with a bright streak of light on their forehead, arms, and legs due to the traces of ablution. That's mean light. So, if any of you can lengthen his streaks of light, he should do so. This hadith was reported by whom? We said Muttafaqun Ali. What does it mean? Muttafaqun Ali, agree upon. Huh? That means whenever say agree upon, Muttafaqun Ali, that means it was reported by Al Imam Al Bukhari and Imam Muslim. Rahmatullahi alayhima. طيب when he said سمعت طيب سمعته يقول that means I heard the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم is saying this إن أمتي أمة my أمة. You remember we talk about the أمة of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم before. Huh? Who is the أمة of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم? Huh? Huh? Okay. My brother here, he said, the Ummah of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, everyone from the time that he was sent as a messenger till the last day. This is the definition of the Ummah of Muhammad. Is this correct? Nobody has an objection? How about the kuffar, ya Sheikh? The kuffar, are they? Don't speak, please. The kuffar. Are they of the Ummah Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam?
Because the message was sent was universal.
Nah.
As I understand, whether you follow or not, it's they are part of.
Of the Ummah, mashallah. Good. Jazakallah khair. That's great. Yeah, mashallah. But is there a difference between the two group, the believer and the believers? Yes. What do we call them? I discussed this before and explained it. I think I will make exam at the end of the semester, inshallah. At the end, yeah, to make sure that you are studying. So, yeah, review what we study. Five. Listen to this, it's very important, remember. In general, all people from the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi till the end of the day, this is called Ummat Muhammad sallallahu alaihi. But they are divided into two types. A group who accepted his message, the believers, Muslims. This is called what? Ummat Istijaba. That means responded part of the Ummah. Those who responded and accepted the message. Ummat Ijaba. Yeah, write this. The other group called Ummatu Dawa. Ummat Da'wah. That means they are entitled to receive the da'wah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Which means that it is our duty, those who believe in Allah Azza wa Jal and His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it is their duty to what? To convey the message to anyone else. If he didn't hear the message or if he doesn't know about Islam, then it is our duty. It is our duty to tell them. And please, brothers, don't be shy to convey the message of Allah to whoever you know of those who don't believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Otherwise, you will be responsible and questioned by this at the day of judgment. Don't because you are working with some, and you say, well, I'm not going to talk with them about Islam, and I would like just to do my job, and it's not of my business. I said, okay, it's not for your business, but will be questioned at the day of judgment, because these people, they will accuse you. They will take you as an excuse for their fault. They say, oh Allah, we were working with so and so. So and so was my neighbor and he's a Muslim. He never told me what is Islam. He never told me what is Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who is he. Okay? All your duty is what? To convey the message. Tell them. They accept, alhamdulillah. They didn't accept, you did what? You did your job. Naam? So no. This is very important. So this is called Ummat Da'wah. So we have then two groups. Ummat Da'wah and Ummat Ijaba. Right? Ummat Da'wah, those who did not believe for any reason. Even they didn't hear about the message of the Prophet ﷺ, or nobody convinced them, nobody told them, nobody invited them. طيب we should, this is Ummat Da'wah. The other group, the Muslim, the believer, Ummat Ijaba. Ijaba, this means they respond to the message of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. طيب, now this straight light that's come on the, as a result of the wudu, this will be the sign of Ummat Da'wah or Ummat Ijaba. Which part? When you say my Ummah, does this mean everybody who came after the Prophet in the Day of Judgment will come with this light? No, not all. Only the part who believed in the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Why? Because he mentioned here, min athar al-wudu, because of the trace of the wudu. So the one who don't believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, does he make wudu? The one who is not a Muslim, does he make wudu? following the way of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he does that. So this sign at the day of judgment, this will be, it's like good sign for those who perform wudu in this world. So at the day of judgment, they will come and their light in their heads, their hands, their, and this may be mentioned what was subhanallah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said about the believer, that the believers, men and women, يَسْعَ نُورُهُمْ بَيْنَ أَيْدِيهِمْ وَبِأَيْمَانِهِمْ. The light of the believers, men and women, it will be in front of them and their side. يَقُولُونَ رَبَّنَا أَتْمِمْ لَنَا نُورَنَا. The munafiqeen, the hypocrite, they don't have light. They don't have light. Why? Because even they perform wudu, but they do it, they don't do it as ibadah. They don't have the intention, the akhlas. So they deceive you. You tell them, okay, brother, we'll pray, okay, we'll go, and he'll make wudu. But in fact, he doesn't believe in this wudu. He doesn't believe in this. He just do it because, you know, he's among some people, he's looking for some, this worldly benefits. So this will not be light at the day of judgment for him. So this is to show the importance of sincerity. Right. قال يأتون يوم القيامة. طيب سبحان الله يوم القيامة. Many times if you look at the translation, they call it day of judgment, day of resurrection. يوم القيامة has many different names in the Quran. Maybe you notice, يوم الحشر, right, الواقعة, إذا وقعت الواقعة, الصاخة. Many different names. And one is Al-Qiyamah. This is the one that mentioned and repeated many, many times. So the exact meaning, please turn off your mobile, brothers. Put it in silent mood. Jazakum Allah khair. So the one, in fact, who perform wudu, he should make isbagh al-wudu. That means he do it as perfect as he much as he can, and should cover all origins of what? The parts of the wudu. This is called isbagh. We talked about it before. طيب. قال يأتون يوم القيامة. They come at the day of al-qiyama. Why they call it يوم القيامة? Because this day it's called يوم البعث. يوم البعث ويوم الحشر ويوم القيامة, right, and many other names, but he said here القيامة. So what does it mean? Why this day it's called يوم القيامة? It's called because of three reasons. The first one, that people will, you know, قيامة from قامة, that means what? Stand up. قيامة ولا قيام, that means stand up. Tamam? Noun. Qiyama. The day of standing. The day of standing up. This is the one, the exact literal word by word translation of the name Yawm al-Qiyama. The day when of stand up, standing up. Right. It's called first because at that day people will come and stand from their graves. They are sleeping. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent their soul to their body, so they open their eyes and they will stand up. قال عز وجل يوم يقوم الناس لرب العالمين. Surah Al-Mutaffifin. Surah Al-Mutaffifin. When all mankind stand up. Stand up. Another ayah said فَإِذَا هُمْ قِيَامٌ يَنْظُرُونَ. When you have a surah, when the angel Israfil blow in the horn, and then what? فَإِذَا, right away, فَإِذَا هُمْ قِيَامٌ يَنْظُرُونَ. That means they stand up and they are looking. Subhanallah. Right. So this is the one. Also it's called يَوْمُ الْقِيَامَةِ because it is the day when adil justice is established. In Arabic it said aqama al-adl, that means establish justice. Aqama al-adl. So Allah Azza wa Jalla said, وَنَضَعُ الْمَوَازِينَ الْقِسْطَ لِيَوْمِ الْقِيَامَةِ فَلَا تُظْلَمُ نَفْسٌ شَيْئًا. So the day of justice here. Why? Because the justice will be established at that day. So this is another reason why they call it يوم القيامة. The third one, when the ashhad, the witnesses, also will stand up to look and they give their testimony and their shahada. This is in Surah Ghafir. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, Inna lanansuru rusulana walladhina amanu fil hayati dunya wa yawma yaqumu al ashhad. When al ashhad, when those witnesses stand up to give their testimony. Subhanallah al azim. Who are the ashhad? The ashhad, first of all, Ummat Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will testify for other prophets. Stop just for a few seconds for the adhan. Allahu Akbar. So now let's go to tafsir. Ya'tuna ghurran. The word ghur, what does it mean, ghur? Ghur or al-ghur in the Arabic, you know, meaning, it is the horse, the female horse especially, which has white in its front. You know, there are some horses. So one of the beauty of the horse, especially the female horse, if there is white hair on the head of the face, I mean the hair of the face, the head of the horse, they call farasun aghar, aghar. And this is what we call it in Arabic, ghurra. The ghurra is the beginning of the thing, the beginning of the head here. This is called ghurra. So the beginning of everything is ghurra. And this is why you said about the month. Said ghurratu muharram. Ghurrat muharram. What does it mean, ghurrat muharram? The first day, the beginning of muharram. Ghurratu shahr ramadan. That means the first day of ramadan. The word ghurra, so it is the first part here. So this white. So the Prophet ﷺ, he gave this example. وَقَوْلُ مُحَجَّلِينَ التَّحْجِيلِ, which is the whiteness that circulate the legs of the horse also. You see some horse, there is white color which circulate part of the leg. So it's like a beauty here. It's like white in both, in the head and in the leg. But here, at the day of judgment for the believers, it will not be like a color, but it will be what? Light, straight light. that will be in their head and in their hands and in their legs. نعم, this show that this is some of the benefit they get. قال من أثر الوضوء. He said من أثر الوضوء. This is as a result of the wudu, of the ablution. That's mean the one who perform ablution in a perfect way at the day of judgment, inshallah, he will find this ablution was turned to light in his face, huh? On his hands, on his legs, in his arms. طيب. Is this light? Is it because of the water that he used, or it's by because of the ablution? We have two things. We have water and we have ablution. That means the water that we used, but the action is the ablution. So which one? Both of them. Both of them. Because you cannot, you know, cannot make ablution without water. Right or not? So both of them. نعم. طيب. There is one statement which said, فَمَنْ اسْتَطَاعَ مِنْكُمْ أَنْ يُطِيلَ غُرَّتَهُ فَلْيَفْعَلْ. So whoever can extend the length of his غُرَّة, then let him do it. This is word they said, this is not of the word of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But this was inserted by whom? By the narrator, Abu Huraira. He said, like an advice, okay? So if you know this, then whoever can make it extended and longer, let's do it. So some ulama, they said, this is not of the part of the hadith. طيب, you remember when we talk about this our class in hadith, we talk about al-idraj. You remember or you forgot? We have class in hadith. We talk about different types of hadith, different beliefs of hadith, narrators, mustalah hadith, science of hadith. We had class before. We cover all this issue. One of them is al-idraj. They call it al-idraj, insert. So al-idraj is to insert some word which is not part of what the Prophet said, but it is as by the narrator, either to explain the hadith or to explain the meaning of one word. نعم. So some ulama like Ibn al-Qayyim, he said, there is no way to extend the wudu in the face. Why? Because the face is already known, limited. So where you will go? So this is not right. But some of them, they said, this is possible where? When you do to your arms. Right? So in the arms, you wash your arms up to the elbow. So they said this, you can extend a little bit, 1 centimeter behind the elbow. And the same thing for the foot. So this is view of some of the ulama. But the face, it's already design limited. There's no way to go more than this. طيب. طيب. From this, we just to conclude this hadith. From this hadith, we learn that the light and whiteness which will be in the day of judgment will be as a sign of the Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, of the Muslim, the believers. So they will come at that day, inshallah, and their faces brighten with the light, and also their hands and also their legs, because of what? Because they used to wash these parts for the purpose of wudu during their life time in this dunya. And also we learn from this, my dear brothers, that al-jaza'u min jins al-amal. The reward of Allah Azza wa Jal is what? Reflect what you do. So if you do good, you will get what? Goodness. The person who do good, then he will get good. And the one, yad billah, who doesn't do good, then he will achieve the harvest of what he did in this world. الجزاء من جنس العمل. نعم. وذلك الله سبحانه وتعالى said جزاء بما كانوا يعملون. This, what they got of this light, of this brightness, it's all as a result of what they did in this world. This is why the munafiqeen, they will not find light at that day. The munafiqeen. يَوْمَ يَقُولُ الْمُنَافِقُونَ وَالْمُنَافِقَاتِ ha? الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أُنظُرُونَا نَقْتَبِسْ مِنْ نُورِكُمْ. The hypocrite, they will say to the believers, men and women, please wait for us. We don't have light. So we'll walk with you, you know. You are the one who have the lamp with you. And we'll look. قِيلَ لَهُمْ رِجِعُوا وَرَاكُمْ فَالْتَمِسُوا نُورًا. Okay, go back and get light for yourself. Can they come back to this world? To dunya? There's no way. قال عز وجل فَضُرِبَ بَيْنَهُمْ. At that time, when they go turn, you know, they find there's no light for them, so they cannot see their way. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then will make a wall between them. فَضُرِبَ بَيْنَهُمْ بِسُورٍ لَهُ بَابٍ بَاطِنُهُ فِيهِ الرَّحْمَةِ وَمِنْ ظَاهِرِهِ مِنْ قَبْلِهِ الْعَذَابِ. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala increase us all in knowledge, and inshallah we'll stop here. We'll go to Salatul Isha. And then after the salah, inshallah, we'll come back to for our aqidah class. Jazakum Allah khair. Okay? طيب. Any question? Huh? Yes.
Some people, even we are also doing this. We already have wudu. When you have a shoe and socks.
Yes.
You remove the shoes and just put the water. Is it a...
No, you don't have to. This depends. This is what we call it al-mas'h al-khuffayn.